Hello and welcome to this PTGui tutorial series. In this segment, we'll talk a bit about the background of PTGui, the process of generating a panorama, and what kind of things you need to think about when trying to capture images for later stitching. Where does the name come from? Well, PTGui started as a Panorama Tools GUI. In other words, it was a graphical user interface for a software library called Panorama Tools, which was purely command line based. But today it no longer uses Panorama Tools, it has everything built in, such as a Blender or a Stitcher, and of course the graphical user interface. It runs on both Mac and Windows. You can use it with any kind of camera or lens. You can even scan your photos and stitch it together later on. You can have single row or multi-row panoramas, and you can output in many different projections and file types. So from a simple panorama where you're just stitching together some normal images when you didn't take the wide angle with you, to fully spherical panoramas, and you can even have some interesting output projections such as Little Planet. There's no limit on size. You can create huge, massive gigapixel panoramas, and thanks to GPU acceleration, this actually can go a lot quicker than you might think. It can be both used in a fully automated way, but it also has a whole bunch of completely manual controls. It supports HDR photography and even has its own tone mapper built in. So how do we actually create panoramas? Roughly, it's a three-step process. First, you want to create some images. You know, you take a photo with a camera or however, but you produce some images. Then in the other step, you want to assemble or stitch those together so you create a seamless transition from one image to the other. And the third step is present your image. If it's a simple flat panorama, you can just print it or post it on your website, all the way to a fully spherical panorama where you might need some kind of interactive viewer to display it. In these three steps, PTGui is fully at home in the second, in the assembling or stitching part, but it can also help you with presenting the images because it has a little web viewer built in that you can use. So roughly, how does it all work? Well, the core process is that PTGui needs to figure out how these images need to be laid out relative to each other. Then, when it knows that, it needs to also warp those images to compensate for the particular hardware that you use, the type of lens, or the type of sensor, etc. And then, when that's done, it just needs to blend across the transitions and hopefully produce you a beautiful, seamless image. Does that sound straightforward? Well, it pretty much is, except for one little challenge, and that's parallax. So what is parallax? Parallax is usually defined to as some kind of apparent change in position between objects at different distances from the camera. While that's desirable in videography because it gives you depth to the image, it's the complete opposite with panoramic photography. We really want to get rid of it. So how do you get rid of it? Well, that's by rotating not around the body of your camera, but around the lens, in particular a specific point in the lens, referred to as the no parallax point, or sometimes the nodal point. So look at this demonstration here. On the left hand, I'm using a panoramic tripod head, which is well set up to rotate the lens around that specific point, compared to your average tripod head on the right, where the lens is just moving all over the place. What difference does that make? Well, let's look at this demonstration here. I've set up a selfie stick quite close to the camera, and what I want you to look at is how it changes relative to the background. On the left video here, I'm using a well-calibrated panoramic tripod head, and you can see when I'm stabilizing the video, the relative position doesn't really change. If you look at the right video, on the other hand, it's moving all over the place. And that becomes a big challenge because what we want to do in panoramic photography is stitch these two images together. So when the camera is at the leftmost position, that's one image. And when it's at the rightmost position, that's another. And those we want to overlay on top of each other. And that's simply very, very hard to do when the objects in the image kind of move relative to each other. So you can't just overlay the pixels on top of each other. So when you're shooting architecture with lots of straight lines, or when you're shooting things that are really close by the camera, then this parallax effect will have a huge impact on the quality of your panorama. So that's why we really recommend you use one of those. You can get away without using one in some nature scenes where there's sort of a very chaotic subject matter, then the Blender can kind of hide some parallax problems. But to make it very clear, we definitely recommend you use a panoramic tripod head to make your life a lot easier. And that panoramic tripod head has to be well calibrated. How do you do that? Well, have a look at the links below and we'll link you to another tutorial that shows you exactly how to do that. When it comes to shooting, you definitely want to shoot in manual mode. So you want to use a constant aperture setting, exposure time, ISO, white balance, etc. PTGui can compensate for some variations in those, but you really get best results by using constant values for each and every frame in your panorama. While it's perfectly fine to just stitch the JPEGs that come straight out of your camera, Like in general photography, you will get some better quality by shooting in RAW and then developing those images in a proper RAW developer. There you might tweak things like exposure, brightness, contrasts, colors, the white balance, you might apply some noise reduction, tiny bit of sharpening, and you definitely want to correct for some chromatic aberrations in the images. But while we're at the lens correction topic, do not touch the geometric distortion of the images. PTGui is a lot better at that. And also, be really careful with highlight recovery and shadow detail enhancements, because they will change the overall exposure between images and you might get some banding issues when you're trying to blend those later. When you're shooting the images, try to have about 10 to 20% overlap between the different frames. This will give a PTGui a good chance to figure out how these images are laid out relative to each other and what sort of lens was used. And third, you might shoot HDR brackets, so different exposure levels, but this is a big topic and we'll treat this later in a separate tutorial. That's all for this segment and hope to see you in the next one.